Amen. Thank you, Sharon. If you have your Bibles, we're going to turn to a couple of places now, because it's important you see the Word of God. Amen? Amen. So our text will be Romans chapter 15. So if you want to turn there, we'll begin in Romans chapter 15. When you find it, say amen. You ready for the next one?
Yep.
Matthew chapter 25. We'll be looking at verses 34 through 40. Matthew chapter 25, verse 34 through 40. Now you ready for the last one? I think Gail's putting them up there as I speak, so you'll be able to look at them. It's Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10, verse 27 through 32. So they'll be up here on the screen if you have forgotten. Now go back to our text in Romans chapter 15, beginning in verse 15. Would you stand with me in honor and reverence to the reading of God's holy, infallible word? Romans chapter 15, verse 15. Nevertheless, brethren, I've written more boldly to you on some points as reminding you. How many of us need to be reminded of some things? Paul uses that phrase a lot in the scripture because he knows God's people forget. And so he says, reminding you, because of the grace given to me by God, that I might be a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering of the Gentiles might be acceptable, sanctified by the Holy Spirit. Today I'm beginning a mini-series on the mission of the church. We've been looking at the will of God, and now I want us to center on the mission of the church. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to you grateful for this day and for this time together. We ask now, Father, that you begin to examine every soul, every heart. Draw that which is lost to salvation. Reveal to your children truth. Reveal to us where we are with you and where you want to take us. And have us to evaluate our lives with truth. Now, Father, we pray that the Spirit of God would take the Word of God and that you would do a mighty work in each of our hearts. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And all God's people said, amen. You be seated. This mini-series, which it'll only be 3 weeks long, that's why it's called a mini-series. This mini-series is inspired by God, and it began 21 years ago. When I first came here as pastor, I sat down with the leaders that we had left here at the church, which there were only 12, and we sat down and we looked at scripture and we came up with a mission statement. Now, this mission statement is to give us purpose and motivation for everything that the church does. Here's our mission statement. It's right up here, Gail. Great job. She put it up here. It is to minister to the community, win souls for Christ, and you take it down, and to nurture each other in our Christian walk. It is a threefold mission statement. And God, for some reason, and I think I know the reason, because God has richly blessed us. We've had so many new people and new faces come to our church and be part of our congregation. We have lost some through death and other ministries and other opportunities. But God, when he began speaking to my heart about teaching the will of God and preaching the will of God, instantaneously took me to our mission statement and said, we need to be reminded. We need to be reminded of the purpose and motivation for what we do as a collective group of believers. I've only preached this one time in 21 years, so it's not like you've heard this a bunch. Y'all right? This mission statement was founded in Scripture. It is based on biblical principles and therefore is undisputed. You can't argue with what God says. And so I just want to take a few weeks to remind us. We've got so many new people, and many times new people feel out of place. They don't know why we do what we do, what we do, who we do. And so I'm going to begin by answering the what and the who today. I want to take the first part of our mission statement, and I want to preach you where it came from in text and remind us of what God has placed us in this body. How many of you know for sure, now this ought to be 100% now if it's not you in trouble. How many of you know for sure God has placed you in this place and called you into this body? He has placed each person, according to 1 Corinthians, he has placed every person in this body for his purpose, for his goal, for his work. Now, you're going to fall in all three of these categories. Some of you were one to Christ in this body, and that's why you're here. Some of you came here because you were in great need of great nurturing and fellowship with God's people. And some of you are here as a result of some ministry that this body has conducted in our community, and God has used that to bring everybody together. And so to keep us on the same purpose and will with God, I really felt under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to remind us. Sometimes we forget what we do and why we do it and who we do it to. And God says, in order to stay in my perfect will, you better know what you're up to. And so I'm going to look at the mission of the church. And the first part is, we are to minister to our community. All right, let's take a look at our text here. What does Paul say? Paul says in verse 16, he says, in verse 15, he says, I got to remind you of something. The grace of God's been imparted on my life. And look what he says. Since the grace of God has been imparted, look what happens. He says that I might be a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentile. And so Paul says, every person in this room, if you've received the grace of God, how many of you have received the grace of God upon your life in salvation? All right, this verse is for you. Look at your neighbor and say, this is for us. And so this is for us. Look what he says. He says, that I might be a minister. Now look up here real quick. When we use this word minister in the church today, you know the first thing we think of is paid staff. We think of pastors, youth ministers, music directors, associates, children. How many of y'all agree with that? Now, that's what we think of ministers. We think of people that have a special call from God. Can I tell you that's far from biblical truth? Look what it says here. He says that I might be a minister. This word minister in the Greek text translates. Listen to what it translates. Are you ready? A public servant. A servant of the state. Can I ask you a question? Are you a child of God now? Do you live and reign in the kingdom of God, both here on earth and someday in heaven? And so watch this. It also means, I like this, a servant of a king. How many of you are serving a king today? Watch this. When Paul uses this word minister, he's not using the vocation in the church as we associate with. He is saying, by the grace of God, the grace of God has been imparted into my life in salvation. As a result of that grace, God has made me a minister. He has made me a servant of the state, a public servant to God's people, to other people. I am a minister. You need more evidence and proof? All you got to do is turn to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 7. Look what it says. Whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God. The Bible says it was saved by grace through faith, lest anybody should boast. It is the gift of God. How many of you received the gift of God by grace? We call it salvation. So Paul in Ephesians says, according to the gift of grace of God, given unto me by the effective working of his power, making reference to the Spirit of the living God in you. So if you're saved, you've received the grace of God, you've received the gift of God's salvation, you've received the gift of the Holy Spirit of God, guess what God calls you? A minister. You need more evidence? 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. As every man, how many men is that? He's talking about humanity, mankind. He's not talking about just men, the gender. He's talking about humanity. And as every man has received the gift, there it is again. The gift. The person of the Holy Spirit. Salvation from God. Eternal life. Even so, minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. And so here's what Paul says in our text. Paul says, I've received the grace of God. Ephesians, 1 Corinthians, it said that because we've received the gift, salvation, we are therefore commanded to be ministers. Let me ask you a question. Look up here real quick. Are you sure that you're being the public servant you need to be for the kingdom of God? It's not debatable. You don't get to say, well, God didn't call me to be a preacher. That's a vocation. That is a high call. It is a high call to serve God as a under-shepherd, but everybody in this room, if you've received the gift of salvation, has the same responsibility in the kingdom. That's why our mission statement begins with us taking responsibility for our role in this work of God. We have an obligation, a responsibility to be ministers. So what are we to minister? Look what he says in Romans chapter 15, verse 16. He said, that I might be a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles. Look at this next phrase. Ministering the gospel of God, that the offering of the Gentiles might be acceptable, sanctified by his Holy Spirit. All right, Brother Sam, it's established. How many of you agree? Look at your neighbor and say, I'm a minister. The scripture calls you that. You're a minister, okay? What am I supposed to be ministering? Only two areas. Are you ready? There's only two things you're supposed to be doing. Ready? Number one, you're supposed to be meeting the spiritual needs of others. Look what he says. That I might be a minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel. The word ministering here in the Greek means to minister in the manner of a priest. It means priestly service. What was the priest's main job? Wasn't it to instruct the people of God through the Word of God? Didn't they bring the Word of God into every person's life in the nation of Israel? Didn't he complete the rituals and the plan of God before other people? Didn't Jesus? How many of y'all know that Jesus' primary ministry was sharing the Word? Didn't he teach in the synagogues? Didn't he teach in the temple? When he was with the disciples, wasn't he constantly teaching? When there was a crowd gathered, did he not teach? When they were eating food together, did he not teach? Sermon on the Mount is associated with the feeding of the 5,000. Everything that Jesus did was word-oriented. It began with meeting man's greatest need, that is, spiritual life. Now let me ask you a question. How do we do concerning the spiritual life? See, here's what the church does today. I know I'm not going to get many amens, but I'm just reminding you this is our purpose. I told somebody the other night, and I'm personally have the gift of evangelism. I'd share the gospel a drop of a hat with anybody at any time, any season, anything. It don't matter to me. I'll give you the hat to drop. I have the gift of evangelism. I can talk and gab and carry on and do all those things. I can become all things to all men and hope to win them all to Jesus. But the greatest experience of growth in this church has not been because of my evangelism and my gift. It has not been because we have done evangelistic things in the community. I can take you through 21 years of history here at Woodhaven Baptist Church. Every time there has been spiritual growth, adding the number of spiritual lives in this church, it is when you, everybody on this side and everybody on this side, you did the purpose by which God saved you and you ministered the word to other people. It's you inviting your family, your friends. It's you that has a neighbor that's going through a divorce or a neighbor that's facing death or sickness and you cared about, you know, and you brought that person here. You went to them and you said, I'm praying for you. I'm lifting you up. I'm bringing you before our church. Our church is praying for you. You actually cared enough for that person that you did the one thing that you're mandated to do as a minister, and that is to minister the word of God. It never fails. Every spiritual growth here has been the result of God's people doing the mission by which God saved them to do, and that's to minister the word. Our number one goal to the community is to share the gospel. Now watch this. A lot of churches do good in that, don't they? Some of them do fair in that. Some are weak. You know what some churches say? Some churches say that's the staff's. That's Brother Ross's job, Brother Gary's job, Brother Sam's job. Our job is just to come and sit and be here to encourage them and take in the preaching and give our tithe and let them go do the work. That's not what God said. That's not what Paul was teaching. Not what Peter said. He said, we've all received the gift of salvation by grace. Amen. And you're called to be a public servant, a public servant of the state of heaven. You are to be a servant of the King. Yep. How many of y'all scared to share the word of God with other people? Go ahead and raise your hand. I already knew. You don't want to walk up the door, knock on the door and say, hey, can I come in and share a cup of coffee with you and tell you about Jesus? Y'all all right? That's not what, we're not built like that, are we? We're not built to just go and do all those things. And yet the scripture teaches that's exactly what we've been saved for. Now watch this, not only are you supposed to meet the spiritual need, according to Matthew chapter 25, if you want to turn over there, according to Matthew, you're supposed to meet the physical need. Matthew chapter 25. You know the story, don't you? Jesus separates the sheep from the goats. How many of y'all know that story? He said in heaven there'll be goats and there'll be sheep. And on the left will be the goats and on the right will be the sheep. He's going to separate us. And by the way, you know you can be, you ought to know whether you're a sheep or a goat. Jesus already knows, amen? Now look what he says. Let's begin in verse 27. Excuse me, verse 34. I looked at the wrong thing. Look at verse 34. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, talking to the sheep. How many of y'all know you're on the right hand of God? I'm a sheep. Bah. I'm baying like one. Y'all right. I'm a sheep. Then the king will say to those on the right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Look what Jesus said, verse number 35. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. I was naked, you clothed me. I was sick, you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will answer and say to them, surely I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. Now let me tell you what Jesus says. Jesus says, it is the mission of the church It is the mission of every brother and sister that has received the gift of salvation by grace from God. It is our responsibility to meet their spiritual need, salvation, the gospel. But it's also our responsibility to meet the physical needs, food, clothing, shelter, protection, counsel. Now, some churches do real good at meeting physical needs, but do a terrible job meeting spiritual needs. And there's some that meet spiritual needs that don't meet physical needs. Here's what Jesus says. My sheep meet both needs. We have lots of opportunities here for us to help. We have so many feeding ministries. We feed the football team. We feed the ROTC. We'll feed anybody. At the drop of a hat, we'll fix food around here. Amen? We're Southern Baptists. I mean, we'll do whatever's got to be done. Our senior adults are going to start in March feeding on Wednesday nights. We're going to return to family night dinners where you can come on Wednesday night and eat with your family here and then come into prayer meeting and go to youth functions and do all of that stuff. It's amazing how many people you can get to come to church when there's nothing else to offer. You offer them food, they'll come. We have a food pantry. I don't say this enough, but our senior adults primarily, there's some of us that give and do to it, but primarily our senior adults do all their fundraisers. You know what they do with the money? They take all the money and keep our food pantry stocked so people in our community that are needy for food. And I got news for you, even some of our church members that are down and in need of food. For whatever reason, sickness, finances, whatever the reason, we don't ask. We just, if they need it, they're hungry, we provide it for them. If there's a need for clothing, you folks have always been gracious in giving and making sure that need is met. We have a benevolence fund. Some of you, I'm sharing this. You say, Bill, see, you're not really preaching to me this morning. Yeah, I really am preaching to you because your tithe and offering goes to every bit of this stuff, and this is what we use it for. We use it not to pay salary for other people to do what we're all supposed to be doing. That's part of it, but we do it to do things like the Scripture says. We have a benevolence fund where people need help with gas or food, or they need help with something financially. The church allows a certain amount of money to go to help those people out. Why? Because sometimes not only do they have spiritual needs, sometimes they have physical needs. We provide the home of grace for people to go into. Why? There's sometimes people come to this congregation got a problem with addiction. And they need to go somewhere that can give them some treatment and give them some help. And so this church is geared in doing whatever it takes to meet the physical need as God allows us and God blesses us. It's our responsibility to take care of that need. It is not the government's job. Matter of fact, I'll submit to you that if the church did its job, the government wouldn't have to give money. Your tax dollars couldn't be justified to give them to those that didn't have because it's our job. You read the Scripture. It's our job to take care of the widows. It's our job to take care of the homeless and those that are in need. We're supposed to help people find jobs. I got a friend right now needs a job. Y'all know anybody hiring? You need to let me know. Do you run in sometimes people say, hey, y'all know anybody? I need a job. You might drop my business of hiring. It's our responsibility. The churches. It's an opportunity for us to minister. Somebody asked me one time, Brother Sam, what do you actually plan? What is your church plan to get out of feeding the football team? Well, I'll tell you what we get. We get the biblical right to say to Jesus, hey, you know all them kids you brought this way? We not only met their physical need, we also met a spiritual need because they sit in here for 15 or 20 minutes and I share the gospel for 13 weeks, 12 weeks, whatever. And did you know that some of those kids never darkened the door of the church? We had one man that came, matter of fact, he came to, this is years ago now, he came here as a result of our football ministry and feeding the football team. He came through here for 3 years. He came here every Friday night. And when he left, he went to college. When he went to college, he made some bad decisions. How many of y'all know young people can make bad choices? How many of y'all know old people can make bad choices? You don't have no age on that bad choice thing. And lo and behold, one Sunday, I looked up and there was a young man sitting on the back row, and he looked like a visitor to me. I'd never seen him before. And I walked up to him, and I greeted him, gave him a handshake and a hug, and I said, "Hey, I'm the pastor here. Glad to have you here." And he looked at me and said, "Bro Sam, you don't remember me?" I said, "No." He said, "I sit here for 3 years with the football team." And I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "What are you doing back?" He said, "Well, I went to college and I made some bad choices." This is what he said. He said, "When I came back home, I knew I needed to go to a place to get my problem fixed, and this is the place." Amen. Now, let me tell you something, folks. That's ministry.
Yes.
Feeding and meeting their physical need, exposing their life to spiritual needs, and then God changing lives. We never need to lose sight of the motivation and the purpose by which God placed us all together in this body. And that is for us to be ministers. We're to minister to one another. We're to minister. Our life is about ministry. Not paying bills, working a job, and collecting stuff. You do know you'll stand before God someday and you won't be able to hold up those trophies and claim that that's what your life was lived for. He's going to look at you and say, "How and when and what kind of minister were you?" I love what Peter says in 1 Peter 4:10 when he said there that I'm a steward of the manifold grace and gift that God's given me. When you stand before Jesus, he's going to hold you accountable for every opportunity you had to minister for the state of heaven. He's not going to worry about how many years you worked your job and whether you got a gold watch and you retired. He's not going to worry about how much is in your bank account and how you accumulated a 401k that you'll probably never see all that money to start with. But you sure spent your whole life focused on that 401k. You spent your whole life building that house and having those fine houses and fine cars. You spent your life making sure that you worked for the man and moved up the corporate ladder and fulfilled your life with stuff. But along the way, you failed as a steward to be the minister that God says that you are. And there's broken hearts and lost people that along that journey of life, you failed to minister to. That's what we're going to be held accountable for. Y'all right? It's not going to be how many times we did this, do that, do the other things. Sometimes I get my pity party. How many of y'all know I'm talking about a personal pity party? And I see all these people taking all these trips and going to all these places. And I sit there and I go, I'd like to take my kids to see the Grand Canyon. I'd like to go and see the Pacific Ocean. And I'd like to see all these wonders of the world that everybody else is doing. And then God interrupts me and says, "Is it more important to see those things or to be part of what I'm doing?" When I get to heaven, I want my life to matter. I tease people all the time. When I get to heaven, all the men and women from the home of grace are going to holler, "Y'all all right?" When I die, my spirit leaves here and I go to heaven. While I'm standing before Jesus, I undoubtedly somebody's going to holler out, "You all right, Brother Sam? I'm going to be fine." That young man that I told y'all about, he's not the only one that this church has impacted through a football ministry of just simply fixing food. Now we're getting an opportunity to invest in young men and women who are in the ROTC, who most of them, not all of them, but most of them will stand for our country and defend our country. What a great honor it is for us to invest in their lives. Yeah. And to make sure they're spiritually prepared for the things that they're going to encounter. It's a great opportunity. It is all I'm telling you. Our number one motive is to be that which God has called us. And that is a minister. And the what is, what am I to minister? The gospel, spiritual, and physical. Now that is. Let's look at the who do we minister to. our mission statement says that we're to minister to the community. Turn to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10, beginning in verse 25, Jesus has an encounter with, of all people, a lawyer. He says, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit life?' He said to him, 'What is written in the law? What is your reading of it?'" Isn't it amazing? He tried to test Jesus with the law, being a lawyer. And Jesus is going to give him the answer from the law. Look what he says. "So he answered and said, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' And he said to him, 'You have answered rightly. Do this, and you will live.' But he wanted to justify himself, said to Jesus, 'And who is my neighbor?'" Did you notice that he didn't bring up the relationship part? He didn't say, "Do I love you with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my strength?" He didn't bring that part of the law up. What is the part of the law that he went to justify his salvation? It wasn't what the Word of God said. It was what the Word of God said for him to do. Now watch this. Look up here just a minute. It's one thing for you and I to say that we are something. It's another thing for us to be what we say we are. The lawyer said, "I know the law, and I know what the law says, and I know what the number one law is. Love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. And I'm not going to justify my relationship with God based on that law, because I know what the law says, and I do what that law says." He justified by saying, "Who is my neighbor?" Which causes me to ask the question, why would you bring that up if you were everything you were supposed to be to your neighbor? So what he says, look what Jesus says. "Then Jesus answered and said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothes, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a certain priest came down the road, and when he saw him, he passed on the other side. Likewise a Levite, when he arrived at the place, came and looked and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, poured on oil and wine, and set him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. On the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, when I come again, I will repay you.' So which of these three do you think was neighbor to him who fell among the thieves?" And he said to him, "He who showed mercy on him." And Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." Now, the what of our ministry is the spiritual and physical need. The who is our community. Who is our community? Our neighbors. Well, Brother Sam, what is a neighbor? What qualifies? See, we're asking the same question as the lawyer, aren't we? What qualifies as a neighbor? And by the way, the scripture says we're to love our neighbors like ourselves. How much you love you? Which means everything that you would do for you, you should do for others. In your neighborhood. Well, what's your neighborhood? Let's just talk about your neighborhood. Let's run down a few things. All right, who am I to minister to? I know what I'm to minister, the gospel, the spiritual, and the physical needs, but now who do I minister to? What is it? Who is my community? Let's begin with your community, with your family. Anybody in here got family members you know aren't saved? Doesn't that concern you? Doesn't that bother you? Did you know your very first, the very simplest place to start is with those people that mean the most to you? They're your neighbors. It's your family. isn't it a shame that we got family members that could die and go to hell? And by the way, you say, Brother Sam, what's the picture here? Get the picture. Did you see what Jesus drew out for us? That there was a man that was robbed and beaten and left for half dead. Do you know what that man is to symbolize? It is to symbolize those apart from Christ. You know that everybody that doesn't believe is a non-believer, and non-believers are dead people. And dead people go to hell. They'll keep dying the second death, which is eternal separation from God for eternity. They'll never live in hope and in love and grace. They will suffer. Suffering is not living, is it? It's pain, despair, agony. And so here's the picture of this man. He's beaten, he's bruised, the world has cast him aside, he's downtrodden, he's half dead. His only hope is that God sends a priest. A preacher didn't stop. A Levite, a holy man, didn't stop. You know who stopped? The Samaritan. But you know what the Samaritans are to a Jew? They're the worst of the worst. The lowlives. And you know what God says? A true child of God realizes that they once were a lowlife. I was in the ditch. I was beaten. I was dead, dying in my sin when Jesus saved me. And you know how Jesus saved me? He sent some ministers to minister to me, my spiritual and my physical. I can remember, and Pete heard me say this, men named Pete in my life have been very special. Our Pete's very special to me. The guy that helped point me to Jesus, his name was Pete Roberts. He's redheaded. You know how Pete began to reach me with the gospel? Is invite me over to his house to do stuff like roast hot dogs and weenies and play volleyball and to hang out and just get to know one another. Stuff we used to all do. You know what we're doing? We're spending our whole lives with our heads down like this. We don't even know how to talk to each other in the same way. We send texts and blogs and all this other garbage. We don't even know how to talk to one another anymore, let alone try to reach our community with the gospel. And so Pete just loved me. He accepted me. He knew I was a lowlife. He knew I was a drunk. He knew I wasn't right with my wife. He knew that I was a man beaten and left for dead on the side of the road. And yet he met my physical needs, and during that meeting with physical needs, he shared the spiritual need. And guess what eventually happened? Both Sam got saved. And I've been winning people ever since because of one red-headed fellow that just ministered to someone in his community, a neighbor. By the way, if you can't start doing what you're supposed to do with the ones you love the most, your family, what makes you think you're going to do it to a total stranger? Some of you got family members that looks just like this guy dead on the side of the road. He's bleeding to death. He's dying. And everybody keeps walking by leaving it to somebody else to do. Y'all right? You walk by them every day, every month you see them. You walk by them all the time and you're saying things like this: I'll pray, but I can't reach them. Somebody else going to have to do it. They call Brother Sam, text him. Brother Sam, my brother needs to be reached with the gospel. Okay, I'm going to start sending back. Well, what are you going to do to minister to him? Invite him to dinner. Take care of the need. Share the gospel. My brother called me yesterday, and he said, hey, man, I was at the red light right beside you and blowing the horn and waving at you, and you didn't take 5 minutes to speak to me. I said, well, I'm sorry. He said, what was you doing? I said, well, if you want to know the truth, I was in deep prayer with God driving down the road. He said, do you do that? I said, yeah, I just don't get in deep prayer right here at an altar. Y'all right? Matter of fact, if you rode with me before, you probably are in deep prayer. just saying, you know, you might be in deep prayer. And when I drive, I have to get in deep prayer to keep from getting in my flesh. And I didn't know my brother was sitting next to me. And he and I talked and we laughed, and I got to share the importance of being in deep relation with God all the time. Hey, folks, your family is part of your community. Hey, what about friends? Anybody here got friends that are lost? Hey, what about the people in your community, the area by which you live? I've been, for 21 years, I've been trying to reach my neighbors. One of the greatest joys in my life was last Easter, my next door neighbor, A.D., looks like Willie Nelson. Y'all remember seeing him, got the long hair and all that? He does, and he plays an instrument. He's in a country band, and they do, I'm just saying, they do the casino thing. They play on Friday and Saturday nights. He's built a recording studio right next door to our house. And I love A.D. Me and A.D. has been like this for 21 years, and I've been trying to reach him with the gospel and sharing the gospel with him and helped him through some family issues, and he and his wife, and we exchange Christmas together. Our kids take over cookies that we make, and they bring over fudge. And I mean, it's a great neighborly relationship. And every time I see A.D., I'm sharing the gospel with him. And last Easter, lo and behold, sitting right here, I still remember it, I look up, and lo and behold, there is A.D., and he's in his cowboy boots and his blue jeans. And I mean, tears start. I was like, oh my Lord, for 20 years, I've been trying to get him here. You say, well, Sammy didn't stick. Folks, we look too much at whether they stick or not. My job's not to worry about them sticking. My job's to keep on ministering until God changes them. And I ain't stopped 20 years. My other neighbor that lives right down the street, he's a drunk, and every chance I get to talk to him, I share with him, and I pray for his family. My other neighbors right across the street, they're real cold and distant. They're not even friendly. They don't even wave at me. I think they've already got the word. There's a preacher lives there, and they just, I mean, I'll throw up my hand and say, good morning to you, and they'll be like, but hey, folks, my job is not to give up and just stop just because they're not responding. My job is to take every opportunity and every chance I can to minister. How many of y'all living in subdivisions, or you're living in places you don't even know who your neighbor is? Well, you don't know who lives on the other side of you, behind you, whatever. You just staying there doing your own thing in the little home that God's given you. Just camped out there taking care of business, and, you know, you might throw up a hand or whatever. Those football players I talked about that come every week is our community for 13 weeks. 13 weeks. They're our community. You know all them women that come here from the home of grace all the time? That I know y'all get agitated when we put a reserve up here and all y'all on this side, y'all got to move. Bless God you don't get your little seat, amen? And we got 35 women here. That's our community. And God's busting them here and bringing them to us. My only question is everybody doing what they're supposed to be doing and ministering to them? Or is the only minister they're going to have at Woodhaven is me? Anita. It's our job to minister. Our community, I'm going to sum it up, our community is all those that are in our immediate influence. Family, friends, social, rec. You got people you do fun stuff with? I don't do any fun stuff, so I don't have any. I know I'm not part of a hunting club. But if you are, that's your ministry. There's your opportunity. I'm not part of a fishing team. If you are, there's your opportunity. But among all the motorcycle folks you ride with, when you get back to riding his hips back, it's good to have him back with us, amen? And that's your community. God's given me that stupid horse. Guess what? I'm fixing to have a new community. Are y'all getting the picture? Your life is important to God, and it's important to this church, and it's not just important what you do here. It's more important what you do out there in your community. Amen. It's your community. When we had Miss Courtney Hubbard go to heaven, I was blown away. Now, this will sound like I'm bragging, but I'm not. I was blown away by how many people was at that thing that knew Brother Sam and knew our church and knew what we were about. Because we ministered. It kills my daughters. They said, David, we can't get by with that. At the high school, everybody knows you. That's what you call ministry. By the way, it'd be a shame if I was living in this community for 21 years and had two kids graduate from our high school, with two more about to graduate from high school, and people not know who I am. And by the way, look up here now. I'm going to read this. It's a shame that you've lived some of the places you've lived for 20 years and nobody, you've worked and you've hung out with people, and it's a shame that people don't know who you are because you've never ministered. You're waiting for them to get here. Or you're waiting for somebody else to do it. We began our mission statement with this phrase, to minister to our community. It's not just Ocean Springs in general. It's not just the Mississippi Gulf Coast. It's at your workplace. It's at your workplace. It's at your workplace. It's in your home, on your street, in your neighborhood. It's in school, where you guys hang out and go to school all the time. It's your place to minister. Is it your job? Is it your retirement? Your bus? My God, he's got kids on there every day. They can't jump off. He's got a closed, enclosed area, doesn't he? If I was going to have any noise on there, it'd be Christian music rocking, boy. Just give you behind me, Satan. Get them little demons down. Amen. He's got a captive audience. Amen. Ain't it good to laugh a little? Look here. Let's get serious for just a minute. You need to ask yourself, are you doing what God's saved you? Are you, you're a steward of the salvation he's given you and the grace that he's shown you. What kind of minister are you? You good, you bad, you average? How you doing in reaching your community? Your community. Not mine. I'm doing everything I can to reach mine. And doing everything I can to reach some of y'all's. I look right over here at this section right here. These folks right here in these four pews right here. All them's a result. All them's a result of their son going to the home of grace and making a commitment to me that he would bring his entire family to church one Sunday. And he did. He kept his word. And as a result of that, look what God done. And while they were here, we've met physical needs, but you know what the great need is? It's a spiritual need. And you know what the Bible says? Likewise. All the grace and all the stuff that God's done for you, likewise, every one of them ought to be doing for all of us. Hey, by the way, is this our community? Shouldn't we be caring about one another and meeting each other's needs and spiritually helping each other grow and develop and do all those things? We'll start off with, who am I? I'm a minister. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm a minister.
I'm a minister.
Now you need to ask yourself a question, my good one, bad one, average one. You may have come in here today and you said, hey, I didn't know I was that. But I showed you through the Word of God, that's exactly what God calls you. Now watch this. What am I to minister? Spiritual, the Word of God. Physical. Sometimes you have to stop and pray with somebody. Not tell them you're praying for them, but stop and pray for them. You might need to take them to lunch. Might need to come off the hill and buy a little lunch so you can invest the Word of God. You might have to load up and go help them move. You know how many times we've moved people in this church? I have to keep working out so I can keep ministering to people and picking up their furniture and stuff. Amen?
Amen.
That's why we need to get Bobby fixed and get Carol fixed and get our youth minister's shoulder fixed so they can help us move people, meet their needs. Amen?
Amen.
Well, watch this. I know what I'm supposed to do. Do you know what you're supposed to do as a minister now? Meet the physical and spiritual. Do you know the whom you're supposed to minister to? Now, here's the great question. Are you willing to do what God's called you and saved you to do? And not just here, but in your community. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Father, would you speak into the hearts of your people? Do what you need to do now, Father. Challenge us, change us, correct us, Father. if we're not being the ministers that we're supposed to be. I pray, Father, conviction would fall and that lives would be changed. So now you speak, and may we be obedient, even to the point of death. In Christ's name we pray. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Paul begins by saying, I need to remind you of some things. Today, this is God's reminder to all of us at Woodhaven Baptist Church. God didn't bring a lot of visitors in today. He's talking to the church. He's saying, don't forget your mission, your purpose, my will for your life. You're a minister. What kind of minister are you? You say, I'm average. Hey, you don't have an average God. I'm good. You don't just have a good God. You have an awesome God, the best God, perfect God. So, oh Lord, Brother Sam, I've been a bad minister. I didn't even know that that's what I was supposed to be doing. I've not been using my stewardship properly. Well, you need to come to this altar and say, Lord, forgive me. Help me to live up to your expectation. Help me to live according to your will and your purpose for my life. Help me to be the minister that I need to be. Hey, I was running down that checklist of your community. How are you doing in it? Are you known as a minister? You got family, you got friends, you got people you do things with, hang out with, go do things with, and they don't even know that you're a child of God. Bible says we'll all be held accountable someday for our lives. And all those things that are corrupt, all those things that will perish, will mean nothing when you stand before God. But I tell you what will be important is what Paul says, may his ministry to the Gentiles be acceptable. When I stand before my God, he's going to look at me and say, I gave you a life, I gave it for so much, so many seasons, what did you do with it? And I hope that I can point and say, Lord, all of these, Father, were my neighbors. And I did to them as you would have done. If God's speaking your heart, you make a decision for him this morning. This altar's open. Brother Ross and myself are here. We'll pray with you, give instruction. Leave here today knowing that you're a right minister with God.